come before you with contrite heart. Humbly I surrender all that I am. I want to learn from you. Please draw me close to you. Help me share your love and grace in all I do. Lord, I come before you with contrite heart. Humbly I surrender all that I am. I want to learn from you. Please draw me close to you. Help me share your love and grace in all I do. Oh Lord, transform me. Change my heart completely to be more like you. Oh Lord, renew me. Heal my mind and broken heart today. I want to be and to do what you commanded, and be filled with the Spirit every day. To serve you wherever you may lead me. I want to serve you till the very end. Oh Lord, transform me. Change my heart completely to be more like you. Oh Lord, renew me. Heal my mind and broken heart today. To be and to do what you commanded, and be filled with the Spirit every day. I want to serve you wherever you may lead me. I want to serve you till the very end. Shine a light to a darkened world, and always live your truth in every way. May your love for me be seen by everyone, and lead others to trust and love you more.
Adventist Youth Live. This evening we're coming to you from the studio at our conference center here in Granbra, and we welcome you. Now, thank you for joining. What we need you to do immediately is to start liking the page, start sharing it, invite your friends to join in, send your hymn requests, and I promise you we're going to have a good time tonight. It's Sabbath. It's a time to sing, praise God, relax. It's the end of the week. I'm tired. I'm happy to be here. How about you?
Amen.
Oh, yeah.
All right, nice. Absolutely. Joining me in studio tonight, we have special guests. To my left, we have...
Kieran Daniel.
Welcome, Kieran. Then we have...
Delana Sterling.
Welcome. Then we have...
Desiree, hi.
And joining us tonight...
Travis Hall.
Nice. So now everyone knows who is in studio. We're happy to have each one of you. Oh, one more thing. When you tune in and when you share, tell us where you're tuning in from. And tell us when you share as well. Okay, before we begin our program officially, let's just bow our heads as we ask God's presence with us. Lord, we thank you for the blessings you have bestowed upon us throughout the week. We thank you for your guidance and protection. And we thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight again to send a message to the online audience. We pray as we go through this tonight's program that some soul will be blessed. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Alright, so our topic for tonight is a simple question. What would you do? What would you do? Okay, we'll delve into that topic as we go along. But first, let's take our first hymn. It's hymn number 434. We speak of the realms. And this hymn is requested by Kel. Thank you for requesting that Kim Hill. That hymn, Kel, is one of my favorites. Second hymn.
We have 608 from Kishel.
608 from Kishel. I believe that is Faith is the Victory.
Encounter long the hills of light, ye Christian soldiers rise. Let all our strength be heard. Faith is the victory we know, that overcomes.
coming to us from Niza. She's requesting hymn number 198. And Can It Be? Mm-hmm. Hymn number 198.
Keaton. Alright, happy Sabbath from Birch Grove, right?
We have Avi.
Good night, Esther.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we have Sherman who just gave us her hymn 614. That's my favorite song, Sherman. Thank you for that. Good night.
All right.
We have Kathy Cumberbatch.
From
Happy Sabbath. She's from St. Vincent and the Grenadines.
Wow. Alright, glad to have you.
Mm-hmm. Nice. We have Sori Philip joining, Dennis George, Dolisha, Rachel. Andrew Scipio.
Welcome, guys. All right,
and remember to keep liking, keep sharing the page, invite your friends to join us tonight. Okay, Kieron, what's the next song?
The next song was requested from Esther, number 476, number 476.
All right, and before we continue, I'd like to shout out my family tuned in. My wife, Deanne, and children, G and Dana. Good night.
Can't forget them.
No.
476. Burdens are lifted at Calvary.
Days are filled with sorrow and care. Hearts are lonely and drear. Burdens are
Travis. Mm-hmm. What's the next hymn?
Oh, next hymn is from Girls 435.
All right, we have Joanne selecting the glory song, is it?
The glory song. The glory song indeed.
Trials are on, and I am safe on that beautiful shore. Just to be near them, the Lord I adore. There through the ages be glory for me. Oh, that will be glory for me. Glory for me. Glory for me. When I am space, I shall look on His face.
Tune in, that's nice.
All right.
And Abigail, shout out the cast of Love Sax and all that jazz for us. Okay.
Yes.
Then we have Nadia Duncan Phillip. We have Zandra Fraser, Pinky Ridges. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Right. Happy Sabbath to all of you. Remember, keep liking and keep sharing. Right. And now we have a special request. By Lovely, number 440.
Nine.
440. Our sharing is the Christian hope. And I like that. I like that hymn as well.
Cornwall.
one more. And I saw someone requested hymn 205. I must tell you something about this hymn. When I was younger, I didn't like this hymn at all. You know why?
Why is that?
Because he keep calling my name in the hymn. Yeah.
You know, these are the golden ones.
Yes, but as I grew older, I learned to appreciate the words more.
Yes.
Right, so the golden morning is fast approaching. Is what would you do?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, a thought came to mind when I was singing the last hymn. What would you do if a hymn is requested and you don't know it?
Well, we could ask one of the persons who are with us to, I don't know.
Right.
Maybe something like that. Live chat and sing for us.
Yeah, something like that could work.
Something like that could work.
All right. So listen to this. There are some situations that we find ourselves in. Situations where we call gray areas.
Mm-hmm.
It's neither black nor white. Gray areas.
Those are fun areas.
Fun areas.
Those are fun areas.
But those are the areas where we need guidance.
Absolutely.
All right?
Absolutely.
Now, tonight's program is designed to provide some scriptural guidance on some of these situations. And we hope that in moving forward, we'll be more specific. You know, oftentimes we say, when we get to that bridge, we'll cross it.
Mm-hmm.
You see that?
Yeah.
But I told my class, was it the week before? If you don't build a bridge now, then when you get to that point, you won't be able to cross over.
You just fall.
Yeah.
That's very interesting indeed.
Yes. Well, before we continue with that topic, we're going to take an item of special music. And I'd just like to shout out some folks joining us again. Who we have?
We have Ina Alexander, all the way from Brooklyn, New York. Hey. Welcome. All
right.
We have Sister Shanina Scott, the wife of Pastor Scott. Good night, Sister Scott.
Good night.
We have Frankie Noel online. Hi, Frankie. Right. He was here with us last week, but he's a bit under the weather tonight. But happy Sabbath to you, Frankie.
Ah, I see my friend Isabel Morris joined. Isabel, happy Sabbath to you.
Have Sister Hadria Charlemagne, if I got that correct. Good night, welcome to you from St. Lucia.
All right.
Right.
Good
Yeah.
to have Grace you with George. Grace George.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I think what we should say, if you don't know the hymn.
Yes.
We appreciate it.
And Frankie said I know the whole song, but I don't know about that, Frankie.
Right. And Grace George, I believe from Guyana.
Oh,
all right, happy Sabbath to you, Grace, and pass on the greetings to Liston as well. All right, so we now take an item of special music.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family. washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join hands with Jesus as we travel this heart, for I'm part of the family, the family. And sisters round here, it's because we're a family, and these are strong here. When one has a heartache, we all share a tear and rejoice in the victory in this family so dear. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join hands with Jesus as we travel this earth, for I'm part of the family, the family. From the door of an orphanage to the house of the king, no longer an outcast, a new song I sing. From rags on to riches, from the weak to the strong, I'm not worthy to be here, but praise God, I belong. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join hands with Jesus as we travel this heart, for I'm part of the family, the family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join hands with Jesus as we travel this heart, for I'm part of the family, the family of God. For I'm part of the family, the family of God. Thank
you, and we thank Sister Philip for that special song, part of the family of God, and we're all part of God's big family. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
All right. Now, I probably should have said this before the special song, but we're getting ready to go into the quiz.
Yeah.
And we need you to invite your friends to come on. All right. Abigail, you can take part. Remember that? Yeah. And then we have Rhonda, we have a couple others, so invite your friends to join in. Welcome Emmanuel, Kareem, right? Nice. Okay, so we go into the quiz tonight. I think we'll start with you, Kieran.
As do you always.
Right.
All right, so the first question. Where is this scripture found? Thy words were found and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of mine heart. For I am called by the name, O Lord, God of hosts. Again, where is this scripture found? Thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of mine heart. for I am called by thy name, O Lord God of hosts.
All right. So where is this creature found? We give it any clues tonight?
Well, we can guarantee that it is in fact in the Bible.
Yes. That's a good clue.
Yes.
Yeah, that's
Ooh,
a good clue.
Excellent. Ooh, we got
wow,
two
wow,
already.
Wow.
Wow. Abigail is on the ball already,
Abigail,
guys.
And then we have Rondell.
Rondell Wilson.
Shelly.
And
Shelly.
Rondell, my primary school friend. Hi, Rondell. And look, he seems to have. Does he have the right answer?
Yep.
Kieran, is the right answer?
Yep. Jeremiah 15:16.
Good
All
job.
Right.
Great job.
You guys are on it tonight?
Yes, 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 yes. Internet and internet services, quick. Google is working fine.
All right, let's move to the second question. Who said the following words? How can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And where is it found? So who said it and where is it found in the Bible? Again, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?
Right, so who said it? How can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?
We've got some people, Rondell, Delisha, you both agreed,
wow,
Joseph.
Yes.
Yes.
Shelly,
yes.
Saying
yes.
Joseph.
Yes,
but where is it taken from?
That's
guys?
Correct. Tell me where it's where it's coming from in the Bible.
The Bible.
Yes, Sherman.
Yes, a lot of Josephs coming in. Yes,
mm-hmm.
yes.
Yes. We have Dan Lee joining.
Oh, here we have Rondell with Genesis 39:9. Is he correct?
Michael also saying in Genesis. Avi saying Joseph. Grace, you guys are absolutely correct. So it
yes.
is Joseph that said the words, and it's found in Genesis chapter 39, verse 9.
All right.
Nice.
It's my turn now?
That's correct.
All right. Okay. I'm going to give you a very easy one, okay? Very, very easy one.
Easy is relative.
Well, yes, it's relative. Very easy one. It says, Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. Where is that scripture taken from? Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. Where is that scripture taken from? Very easy one.
I feel like all
very easy one. And I'm just going to keep the camera on me. Look me straight in the eye and tell me. Alright?
Alright, we have Abigail.
Wow, Abigail
wow.
again.
wow. The answer is on the screen?
Really?
Really?
True?
Someone's giving away the answer.
Oh. yes. Right, we did it the other way around. All right. Well, I'm gonna, see, well, I told you it was an easy one. I told you it was an easy one. All right, nice. Okay.
You're all correct. It's Psalm 119:11.
All right.
All right. The next question is, which major prophet penned the following words? So which major prophet penned the following words? For precept must be upon precept. Line upon line, here a little, and there a little. Say it again. Which major prophet penned the following words? For precept must be upon precept, line upon line, here a little, and there a little. Wow.
We've got answers already.
Dan saying Joel. We have Rondell saying Isaiah. We have Sherman also saying Joel. Abigail saying Isaiah.
Who is it?
Ooh,
50-50
ooh.
Right now.
Yeah. Who is it? Who is it?
It's a toss up between Isaiah
and
Joel. So which answer is correct?
The correct answer is Isaiah. Isaiah was the major prophet to pen those words.
Right.
So good job to those persons who would have gotten that correct.
Right.
Nice.
Travis?
So we have the next question. Which leader of Israel said the following? This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. So which book, or which leader of Israel said the following?
We still have some answers coming in from the previous question. Grace, Rhonda. Wow, Well, and Jola even gave us the scripture where that was taken from.
Dan says Moses.
Good night and happy Sabbath, Thomas.
Dan is re-emphasizing by saying Moses again.
Sure,
Moses.
Agrees with
Moses
as
well. Right.
Yes.
Okay.
You're sure it's Moses?
Are you sure?
We need to see. Nolan is also saying Moses.
Are you guys positive about that?
Anybody?
Think about all these of... Oh, Shelley and Joshua.
That's right. Go against the grain, Shelley.
Be different, girl.
Stand out.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Anybody has anything different?
Grace is Moses.
Right. Google is not working as quickly as it was before. Internet drop. What's happening?
Someone says in Deuteronomy.
So what's the answer?
What's the answer, Travis?
The answer is Joshua.
All right.
Good
right.
job, Shelley.
Nice.
And Niza? Right.
And Niza too.
Okay, nice. Alright, you wanna give it honest to say the other one.
Okay. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Where is this found? I'll repeat again. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly finished unto all good works. Where is this found?
So we have Rondell saying 1 Timothy.
Right. Michael as well. And we have Dan saying 2 Timothy. So is it 1 Timothy or is it 2 Timothy?
Shelley is saying 2 Timothy now.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we agreed.
And Ruby just said Timothy.
Ruby's just like, I'm just a little.
And we have Antonia hosting Noah saying 2 Peter, is it?
Second
Peter 1:21,
yes.
Mm.
And Shelley's
specialized
with verse 16.
Mm-hmm.
Abby is saying
2
Timothy.
Right. 3:16. We have Charmaine saying Timothy 3:16 and 17. So which is it? Is it 1 Timothy or 2
Timothy?
It's 2 Timothy.
2 Timothy. All right.
2 Timothy 3:16-17.
All right.
Good job.
All right. Some of you had the basic idea, which is fine. So you get the verse now, so you can go back and confirm it, you know, and remember it for next time. Okay? Nice.
Yeah.
I think we're in our last question now.
Last question.
That's right. Final question for the evening. Which author instructed us to be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves? So who instructed us to do this? Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. Who was that individual that instructed us such wisdom?
Mm-hmm. Which author said that? Be doers.
And not hearers.
And not hearers only.
Because no one is only half.
Right.
Right.
That's right.
No one is only half.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Paul, I think. Well, I think was his surname or what is it?
Dan is saying James. Ruby saying Paul. Natonia Paul.
Joseph saying James. Kishel James. Rondell James.
Mm-hmm. This time the majority does have it. James.
The majority
is
has it?
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yes.
Very nice.
All right. Good job, guys.
Okay.
Abby, Abigail, Dan, good job, guys.
All right, nice. Remember to keep liking, keep sharing, all right? Invite your friends to join us as we continue. Now, we have some activities happening or is about to happen, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
I think tonight we have something happening at Mount Rose Church. Yes?
Yeah,
right? We have district, is a night of praise happening right now as we speak. Okay, then we have some things happening on Sunday, right? On Sunday, I know Bylands Church has a march followed by Health Fair, I think, in Bylands. And then something has happened later on in the evening at 6. Anybody knows what?
No.
We've been promoting.
Huh?
See, this is what we've been promoting for a while now.
On Sunday, right?
On Sunday.
Yes.
Is that Spice Basket?
Yes.
Alright. It's a play entitled what?
Love, Sax, and All That Jazz.
Alright, nice. So we have the cast from England, right? All the way from London.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I think it's from the directors from Lewisham Church. Right? And they're here. I'm going to put on that play for us. It begins at 6 at the Spice Basket. So once you can make it, head on down to the Spice Basket on Sunday for that production. Right, it promises to be something different,
mm-hmm.
something you wouldn't want to miss, okay? Right. What did I miss? Oh, on tomorrow afternoon, the cast of the play would be at Archibald Avenue.
Woo! Yeah.
Right? Yeah. They'll be at Archibald Avenue and they're going to be doing a seminar there. Right, so those in the vicinity, well, no place in Grenada is far actually. So
that's
yeah,
right.
Yeah, so
20 minutes.
Right, so you can go in and take in some of that. All right, I think that's all I have. Anything else happening that we should know about? That's it?
That's it.
Okay. All right, we still have some persons joining. We have Arlene Carter.
Good night, Arlene.
Right, and we still have Jolan answering part of the quiz. That's very nice, Jolan. I'm going to give you an extra point for the verse. All right.
We have Craig Hilaire joining us. Thank you for joining us tonight, Craig. Happy Sabbath.
As well as Kim Best. Good night.
And thank you all for joining. Right. At this time, we're going to pause again. And take another item of special music, okay?
My mother and daddy talk about going home since I was just a babe on their knees. They said that nothing compares to what was waiting up there. How one day we will finally be free. Well, I've never seen it, but I keep on believing it will be a place like I've never known. I've got my eyes on the sky, 'cause my soul wants to fly. Lord, my heart is ready to go.
I wanna know how it way down the streets of gold. I wanna know how it feels to have a talk with the saints of old. I wanna know what it's like to rest my feet by the river of life. I've heard of heaven and I know that it's real. I wanna know how it.
Sometimes I get weary of this life that I live. It seems like peace is something I'll never find. I try to lighten my load, but all that I've got to show is 700 things on my mind. Well, I'm having visions of a crystal clear river where sins forgotten weed out a trace. More than the look of love on my Savior's face.
I wanna know how it feels to make my way down the streets of gold. I wanna know how it feels to have a talk with the saints of old. I wanna know what it's like. Talk with the saints.
And welcome back. Thank you for staying with us. Continue to like and share the page. I see some folks joining. I think I saw Mickey online. I'm seeing OJ. I see my niece Kathoria, so that means probably my mom and others are viewing. Alright, so thank you for watching. We have Lisa joining. Who else is on?
I think I just saw someone, Gwendy Ann, also from Jamaica.
Hey.
Welcome. Jamaica in the house tonight.
Yeah.
We have OJ Sincere, we have Maurice Williams. Welcome to you guys tonight, guys. Remember to like and share the page.
Mm-hmm.
Lisa Alexander.
Alright, Lisa just joined.
We have Michael Alexander.
Michael is asking for a repeat of the special song.
We're happy that you're enjoying it.
Yeah, stay tuned in, Michael. Alright, and remember to keep liking and sharing the page so your friends will join in as well. Alright, so the topic is... What's the topic again? What would you do? Alright. There's a question and... Sometimes it can be a frightening topic. What would you do? Alright, but let's see. Now, let's examine this scenario. Now, you have a friend, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not a Seventh-day Adventist, but you have been witnessing to him or her, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the ultimate goal is for conversion. Now, your friend works Sunday to Friday and only has Saturday to do chores,
mm-hmm.
right? Now you invite this friend to come to church with you.
Mm-hmm.
But the friend says, you know what, yes, I can come with you, but it's only Saturday I have to do my chores. So, if you come over, you help me do my chores, then we can go to church after. What would you do?
Let the brainstorming begin.
Alright, those of you online, you heard the scenario, you can share. Alright, you have a friend. Non-Adventist, you have been witnessing to them for quite some time. And you know the ultimate objective is to help them to see God as the creator, as their savior, and to become a Seventh-day Adventist as well. Now you invite that friend to church, but that friend works Sunday to Friday and only has Saturday to do their chores. Now they said they agreed to come to church with you, but in order for them to come, they said you have to help them do their chores. So you come over, help do the chores, and then go to church. What would you do?
Well, we're trying to witness.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I know one easy way to lose the power of witnessing is to be wishy-washy. To be kind of warm, kind of cool, not quite firm in what you believe.
Right.
So if you are Seventh-day Adventist and you want to make sure that others know that you're a firm Seventh-day Adventist, to do something that breaks the Sabbath is going to hinder that witness. At the same time, you do need to do something about the situation because you don't want to lose that friendship. You want to be able to have that influence, that positive influence on that individual. But one thing we shouldn't do is compromise on what we know is right.
Amen.
So with that in mind, let's continue with how do we move forward in this situation.
I could say something.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're looking at the scenario where the person has a 6-day work week.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the 7th day is the only day the person could is do all the chores and so on.
Mm-hmm.
How I would look at it is like, I can't do any chores any day of the week. Because definitely we're not doing any chores on the Sabbath.
Right.
Period. So that is out.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't do any chores during the week.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to go forward thinking along that line.
Mm-hmm.
What am I going to do? I can't do any chores at all.
Mm-hmm.
I would suggest that she gets help for during the week. So like get a maid or something that will help her do the chores or do it for her during the week when she can't do it. So that way she won't be doing the chores on the Sabbath. I won't be helping her to do it on the Sabbath either, breaking that commitment I have with God. And I would lead her to Christ the way that I should lead her to Christ.
Okay.
So I would try to help her get someone to help her do the chores during the week. Or if I could do it, help her do it during the week as well.
Alright, good answer.
Got it.
Good answer.
Got it. That's exactly what the same thing I was thinking. If I can sacrifice all of my time during the week that I can help you out with your chores, then that is not a problem for me. I can do it. And then, of course, you'd be free to go to church on Sabbath and keep the Sabbath together. If I may read a comment from Rondell, who said something really interesting. He said, well, you can afford to compromise. You can't afford to compromise, right, in order to bring someone to church. What if you do that and the sermon on the day is on Sabbath keeping? Then your friend will be watching you funny, which is exactly what the other was alluding to with being wishy-washy. They're going to be like, okay, so you're the preacher is saying the Sabbath is so, you know, we need to keep it, and you just helped me do a lot of chores this morning. So, you know, what is your witness really? What does it really mean?
You're on. Any thoughts on that?
I was actually going on the same out of the box thinking of Travis was. I was going to say, like, if there's a day during the week I could help you, like, do your chores, so, you know, that was actually the same thing I was about to say.
Alright, I may have Ruby contributing. Ruby says, come to church, I will wash for you tomorrow. If washing is part of it. Who else is commenting? We have... okay. Right, we have Eugene just giving a shout out on behalf of the cast of Love, Sats, and all that jazz. Okay, Eugene. Alright, now, a lot of people, well, okay, you have chores. It doesn't necessarily mean that the chores has to be done during the day. Well, I don't know exactly what working hours are like, but you can do chores in the evening, right, at night. And I like Ruby's comments a lot because you want the person to come to church with you. The person has a tight schedule, you offer some help.
Yes, indeed.
Right? You offer some help, offer to clean for them maybe on the following day, or to help them wash or whatever the chore is, right? Person probably tired in the evening time, help them probably on a Thursday evening or whatever time you have. Because witnessing is not just about the person coming to church, but just like how Christ would have witnessed, he met the need. So if the person has a need, that needs to be addressed. Yeah. Right, so yeah, all our comments are in line.
Another thing to say, too, like along her point as well, a lot of the things that we communicate is through our actions, and not just through our words.
Right.
I mean, you could say a lot of things and do something else contrary to what you're saying, and you wouldn't grab the person.
Right.
Definitely, because they'll say, what you're saying and what you're doing is two different things. Why would I listen to what you're saying?
And you have Vicky saying, I work Sunday to Friday, so I try my best to do what I have to do in the week. We don't have to do everything on the weekend.
True.
Right, and that is so true, right?
You're talking about scheduling here, right?
Exactly. Exactly. And think about it. Let's just say the person knew nothing about the Sabbath, even though it's like they get no rest because they work Sunday to Friday and then they work all day Saturday, right, doing house chores.
Yeah.
But if they plan better, so you see that could be an issue of planning there as well.
True.
They plan better, then they can get things done during the week, and then the Sabbath, which is made for rest, is when we would rest.
Yes.
You were saying something?
I was going to say, just to bring a bit of, I don't know, maybe it's just my reality and not everyone else's. But I could see myself in this situation and I see what I should do. And what I should do is what we've said, help the person out. But I know my schedule and I know I'm a little tired as well. And I'm also thinking, if I do it this one time, does this mean that I have to repeatedly do it so the individual can continue to come to church? So my, just being honest, I would have somewhat of hesitation in my mind, like, man, do I make this commitment knowing that I'm tired? And then there's that internal battle to speak up, because there really is a great opportunity to witness if you do go, because now you're not just seeing them at church, you're seeing them even at home to help them out and whatnot. So how do we then navigate that feeling of, oh, this is work, even though it's God's work, but this is work?
Well, here's Kelvin Dragon making a good point. You have to help the person to prioritize. One should not be so consumed with work and responsibilities that they cannot perform basic chores during the week. Also, I would emphasize the importance of rest and having a relationship with God, which is so important.
Yeah. So true.
Right? Very, very important.
Yes. So I think as to answer the lady, I think that's a good thing that if we teach or not teach, but at least encourage the person to okay, set aside some time for this and for that and for something else, at least they get time not just to do chores and to work, but they also get time to rest as well, which is kind of what you kinda wanna get them involved in. Resting every week.
That's kind of the mindset of buy a man a fish versus teach a man to fish.
Yeah,
sure. You help them, but you help them to sustain it on their own as well.
And you are so burdened to always have to go and help them do chores and things like that.
And I still think getting them a meal might even help better if they really can't get the job.
If there's no other.
Because I know some persons that really have a hectic work schedule, like some medical professionals. They really can't control their work schedule, and sometimes they really need that extra help. You finding someone to help them is a very good help. Although you're not doing it yourself because your schedule might be bad, you're still getting the help to help the person.
Opening an opportunity for someone to get a job too.
Killing two birds with one stone.
What's Marie saying? Maybe
it's just a form of distraction. Because most persons know seventh-day Sabbath is on Saturday. So I'll make it clear, I can't assist and keep ministering to the person, and one day they will attend service.
Okay.
That's one approach.
All right. Happy Sabbath, Elvin. All right, Lero. Remember Elvin? I'm not sure how many.
Yeah, okay, yes.
National
Harmony back in the day, boy.
Y'all going
to the reunion tour.
Right, so let's take another scenario. Alright, we'll skip this one, we'll come back to that. So I'm going to tell you this one here now. You are supposed to be the main breadwinner at home, but I've not been working for a couple of years. You're supposed to be the main breadwinner. But you haven't been working for a couple of years. So things hard, things tough. Alright, so you have sought gainful employment locally, but to no avail. Alright, so always you try, you're not getting through with a job. But finally, an opportunity opens up outside of the country. So you have to travel. But part of the job requires you that you may have to work on some Sabbaths. So you're traveling to a different country to work. It's a good opportunity. Remember, you haven't been working for a while. Your family is depending on you.
Right?
So part of the job now may require you to work on some Sabbaths. What do you do? It's a good opportunity. Put food on the table for your family. You are the main breadwinner. You have bills.
It's a tricky one.
You have bills to pay.
Yeah.
All right?
Because I can imagine during all that time when the person was unemployed, they would have been praying, Lord, open a way, Lord, I need to provide for my family, Lord, I need a job. And then, no, you get a job, or you get an opportunity for a job, and you have to work on Sabbath. So that person's first reaction is like, well, Lord, what do you want me to do?
You remember, you may have to work, huh? And I'll show you.
May have to work on Sabbath.
But that's where the may, the gray area comes in. You may have to work on Sabbath. But, as a songwriter says, man, I know the songwriter, there is no gray. There is no gray area. The may have to work on Sabbaths is based, is just as saying, you will have to work on Sabbaths. It's as simple as that. So any situation where working on Sabbath is going to be part of it, whether it's one Sabbath out of the month or every Sabbath out of the month, one day the Sabbath you have to work, that's it. It's a position. The Lord says, we do not work on Sabbath. So you do not work on Sabbath. It is difficult, and at that point you might be thinking, Lord, what am I supposed to do? But, you know, as they say, the Lord might just be opening another opportunity for you elsewhere, you know. And if you take this one, you will not avail yourself to be used the other place that God really is opening a door for you.
You know, I just want to take a moment to be empathetic in this situation. I think sometimes we know the textbook answer. Should you work on Sabbath? No. End of story. Let's really all put ourselves in this scenario. In the scenario, you haven't been working for years. Years. And let's just add that you have a family at home. You have people to provide for. So it's not just you alone that is not able to afford the things that you need. You have other people depending on you. And years you are faithfully seeking employment and it's not coming. You might have had opportunities and it fell through. So really put yourself in that in the scenario. Have you been in situations where you've been looking forward to something and you're disappointed and people are leaning on you and, okay, let's all go there mentally. Now, you have the opportunity. This is what you've been waiting for. They call you back. Come in for an interview. You're excited. And you see that you may have to work on some Sabbaths. How do you respond with everything that you know has been going on in the last couple of years? This could be what God has been waiting for us to send you.
That's your answer first.
This could be your answer prayer.
My thing is, why would God answer your prayer with a situation that's going to be a stumbling block for you?
Yes.
I don't believe God says to you, He does not want you to work on Sabbath. I believe in my heart of hearts that God will not provide for you a job where you would have to work on Sabbath. Mm-hmm. Because then He would not be a loving God. He put us in a position to sin, and then that doesn't make any sense. So with everything, it's going to be heavy, it's going to be a lot. I can imagine that person on their knees praying and crying, Lord, what is this? I need this job, but Sabbath.
You know,
at the end of the day.
Go
ahead.
Sorry. You know, that reminds me of Job. Mm-hmm. Job's situation. He was good to God. He did nothing wrong. God said he found favor in his eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden, something bad happened to him. He just came down with this disease. He lost everything. He was like a vagrant on the street right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it reminded me of the same guy. He's trying to do good for his family.
Mm-hmm.
Because you know, if you don't provide for your family, God said you're worse than an invalid,
mm-hmm.
basically. So he's trying to do good.
Mm-hmm.
And for the life of it, he's not getting through. He's not availing. He's not succeeding on nothing.
Mm-hmm.
But yet for all, God left Job in that situation for a while, testing him to see what he will do.
Mm-hmm.
He'll curse and die like his wife told him to do.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a text that I really have a lot of problems with.
Mm-hmm.
Like in applying it to my life,
mm-hmm.
wait on the Lord and He shall renew thy strength.
Mm-hmm.
It's very hard to wait sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Like sometimes you want something right now, and for the life of it, God just not giving it to you. And you're like, God, why are you not giving it to me right now? So it's just like a test. He could be going through a test at that point, then God testing and allowing him to, you know, see he has a job opportunity to provide for his family,
mm-hmm.
and see what he'll do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it could be a test. In the end, if you stand for God, God
mm-hmm.
always stands for you, regardless of the situation.
All right. I just want to shout out my friend Junior George. Junior, thanks for joining us. Good night. All right. Any thoughts on that, Kiro?
I'm going to take a two-way approach to this right now. First point, God does always provide, and I haven't really seen God put someone in a situation where they would have to compromise.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'm just putting that out there,
all right?
Now, on a real note, I have friends, Seventh-day Adventist friends that work on the Sabbath.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot condemn you because, again, it's not my place.
Mm-hmm.
You aren't the breadwinner of your family.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you have some other job that can, you know, get rid of your Sabbath working days.
Mm-hmm.
It is what it is. I can't help. Yes, you can pray. But at the same time, you can't just quit and stay home and just fall on your knees and say, Lord, I need a job, but, you know. Again, this reminds me of a story. There was this guy that was drowning. I think Snubs. I think everybody knows it. This guy was drowning. And he said, Lord, please save me. A boat came by, and the person asked, you need help? He said, no, the Lord will save me. Second boat came by, again, the Lord will save me. Third boat came by, again, Lord will save me. The person ended up drowning, went to heaven, asked God, Lord, why didn't you save me? But the Lord said, oh, I sent you three boats.
Mm-hmm.
So this job opportunity might just be that, you know, boat that person needs to get out of their drowning. So I cannot say, okay, well, you shouldn't do this and you shouldn't do that. Yes, you're not supposed to work on the Sabbath. Again, as Delena said, that is the textbook answer. But on a real note, sometimes we don't live in a Seventh-day Adventist world. If we did, then nobody would work on the Sabbath.
Right.
I want to read this comment from Dolly Shell. She said, "You have not been working for years. You kept the Sabbath and you were right with God, and He took care of you.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a test of faith. Don't take the job." Mm-hmm. Just the fact that she just said you weren't working for years. Mm-hmm. However, your family is still able to
survive,
stay afloat, which means that God was taking care of you for all the years that you weren't working.
Mm-hmm.
He was providing for you.
Mm-hmm.
So, as she said, it may be hard, but your faith at that point should be, okay, Lord, this, you would not provide a job for me where I have to work on Sabbath. I don't think that's something that God's going to do.
Mm-hmm.
As Kieran said, the Lord will not put us in a position where we have to compromise.
Mm-hmm.
So that faith in that moment should be, Lord, you took care of me this far.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll continue to take care of me. So when that job comes along,
mm-hmm,
there's not going to be any compromising situation. It's going to be the job that God has for me.
Right. No, as we were speaking, I was listening to the different comments, right? Travis said that probably there's something that we really want, right? But then God is not giving it to us. So we really want it, but is it a need? Right? That also made a very good point there. I like it. Right? And then continuing, now I saw, actually it was this week, do not leave several things unattended. But I'll just give you one example. You leave your wallet unattended, someone may pick it up and think God is answering the prayer. But no.
It is. Yeah.
Right? The person actually stole it.
Yeah.
Okay? No. The mere fact that you have Saturday involved in the job, it means that God did not send this job for you.
No.
Fair enough.
Straight up. Simple.
Straight up.
Right? God did not send this job for you. It may be a good opportunity for you to earn money.
Mm-hmm.
But then, what does it profit a man
to
gain the world but lose his soul?
Alright. Now, that person needs to exercise more faith in God to realize that God only wants the best for us. Okay? He only wants the best for us. Right? And He would never give us anything that would cause our damnation in the end.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And that comes a matter. Now, we have a testimony from Natonia. She says, but I'm a living testimony that when you stand for God, He would stand for you. Because I was in a situation where I was working on Saturday, then discovered the Sabbath truth, and my former boss used the same words, "You can work some Sabbath." And I said no. And the Lord opened the door with three jobs for me. One of this job is my present job for over 8 years now.
Oh, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Simple, straight.
And I heard one pastor say, "Don't fall for your Ishmael while God is waiting to give you Isaac."
Yes.
You know. So make sure we're paying attention to what is clearly God and what is clearly not God. And if it's not, you just wait for God to give you what is yours.
All right. What does Diane Peter say?
"The Lord said He'll never see my people begging bread. God took care of that individual all these years, and I'm sure He did not have to beg anyone. It is indeed a test of faith." All right. "It's a test of faith, and He can be a witness to the interviewer when He says no work on Sabbath."
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
You can witness. And I actually think sometimes some of those employers are actually using that. Okay, so you're going to work on Sabbath? I know you're an Adventist, but are you going to work on Sabbath? They're actually using that to test you themselves to see how much of a faithful person you are,
mm-hmm,
with your religion. Because sometimes they want to see how much of a dedicated person you're gonna be in your job.
Mm-hmm.
How much of a trustworthy person you're going to be at your job. So it can be a situation where you can also, as the person said, minister even or to witness to the interviewer, witness to the boss, witness to the manager.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Alright, and I'd just like to shout out to Tamara Healer. Alright, she's learning some Sabbath truth with us tonight. So shout out to you, Tamara. Alright, and all those joining, alright. Shout out to you. Like, share. Alright, invite your friends. Denson Charles, welcome. Thanks for joining. We have Arlene, Birdie, Sylvia Lalit. All right, I'm happy that you're enjoying it. And don't keep it to yourself. Keep sharing. All right. Now there was a, we have Lester Prime joining us as well. There was a comment earlier. It was a bit long from Rondell, right? What we need is a change of mentality. A guy like this has a wrong mentality. A tailor who lives close to me was speaking with me one day and saying how you would love to teach some other person how to sew clothes as well. People need not just to pray, but to get up and learn to do something you can. You can be self-sufficient and not dependent on somebody to give you a job. Sew clothes, farm red chicken, learn electrical, learn to repair shoes, open a small business. Learn some way to feed your family and not just sit down and wait.
Amen. You know, waiting on God is an is actually a very active state. You're not taking things into your own hands per se, but you're not sitting doing absolutely nothing.
Right. Okay.
That's true. You could go out in the backyard and make a little do farm.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Plant some crops in the meantime. You know, never know how that could work out for you.
Right. And Alan is reminding us as Christians, where is our trust? Right. Have you been surviving all these years, right? But God,
that's right.
Yeah, good point.
Take
care
of little sparrows, he'll definitely take care.
That's right.
Yeah, he promises us that our bread and water
is sure. Sure.
Okay.
It's unconditionally cake. Sometimes cake.
All right. Now, before we move on to other scenarios, we'll take another item of special music. Let's just take this comment from Sherry. She says, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist and I work Sabbath in and Sabbath out because I take care of an elderly person.
Mm-hmm. And as Christ let us know, it is not wrong to do good on the Sabbath.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll further explore that.
Yeah, when we come back after the break, we'll expound on that some more, right? So at this time, we'll take an item of special music.
He'll never leave me, no matter where I go. He knows my name. He knows my every thought. He sees each tears that falls and hears me when
lovely special music there by Sister Sorana once again. Right, just before we left, we took a comment. It was from Sherry, right? Speaking about she takes care of an elderly person. Now, there are certain rules that govern the things that we do on Sabbath, right? Maybe it's too early to conclude that because we have another question which is speaking a little bit about Sabbath. So maybe when we're wrapping up at the end, we'll conclude that. Okay?
Yeah.
Right. Okay, so I'll save the best. Maybe should I call it the best? Okay, I'll save
most juicy.
Most provoking one for us. All right. Okay. So probably I could just mention that whatever could be done before or after the Sabbath should not be done on the Sabbath.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So if you had time to do it before and you left it to do on Sabbath,
mm-hmm.
then that's wrong.
Yeah.
If you could do it after the Sabbath, and you decide to do it on the Sabbath,
then
that's wrong.
That's wrong.
All right, remember that. Okay. Now, let's take this scenario. You have been witnessing to a friend about Sabbath observance. They finally agree to visit your church on one condition: that you visit their church.
All right. Now, I have a friend that she is not Seventh-day Adventist, okay? And this actually didn't happen. Actually, wasn't, but it did come to her mind. She's not Seventh-day Adventist, but her landlady was Seventh-day Adventist. And her landlady was saying, you know, you should come to church. You and your mom should come to church with me. You and your mom should come to church with me. And so her mom turned around one day and told her, okay, come to church with us. And the landlady kind of went, she started moving funny, as they say.
I'm not surprised. There are, I won't say a few, but I do know of some of Seventh-day Adventists who, I want to put this correct as possible, who would not go to another denomination's service on their service day. So, okay, they will go to a funeral in a Catholic church because that's a common service, but they would not go to a Catholic church on a Sunday during Mass.
Mm-hmm.
Right? My personal belief is, or where I stand on the whole thing, is that I am not going to the Catholic Mass to be a part of the Catholic Mass. I am not going there to observe any of the religious teachings of the Catholic Church. I am going to the service as a courtesy to my friend who has agreed to come to church with me. So if they are willing to come out of their comfort zone to come to church with me, then I don't see it as a problem to come out of my comfort zone as well to go to church with them. I don't see that as a problem. That's just me.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone else?
So I actually read something on Ellen White,
mm-hmm.
on this specific topic,
mm-hmm.
attending other churches,
mm-hmm.
and she said that she saw that neither young or old should be attending any other churches other than the Seventh-day Adventist Church,
mm-hmm.
unless the Lord led them there to go,
mm-hmm.
unless the Lord specifically told them to go there.
Mm-hmm.
She said, do not take on your own account and go there,
mm-hmm.
because God will not... She put in a way like God will not like assist you in any way if you go there on your own account.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, she also said that you shouldn't be like encouraging false teaching.
Mm-hmm.
That's what she said in the whole section.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I understand what she's saying, because
mm-hmm.
if you go there, you're saying, okay, good, continue doing what you're doing because you're teaching something.
Mm-hmm.
And could be right. I agree. I mean, maybe you shouldn't go and encourage something false,
mm-hmm.
but if the Lord leads me to go there or tells me specifically I need you to go there to bring light or to do something,
mm-hmm.
I will go. If He leads me, if I get the guidance, go.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't take on my own account and just pop into the next man's church because he invite me or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, okay.
If I could share a personal experience, I met an individual while I was at work in the hospital, and long story short, she was really drawn to me for whatever reason, and we prayed together in the hospital, and it was a great experience, and she ended up inviting me to her church. I did attend. Prior to even meeting her, I was praying to God to, if He wanted me to minister to someone or to witness to someone, to send me someone. I tend to be a little bit reserved, and I'm like, God, get me out of my comfort zone, let's go. And He did. So I did attend the church, and I think one, it is along with, it is in line with what Ellen White said, where did God lead you, or are you just going out of your own merit, or do you just like the way that the music sounds there, or what have you? Mm-hmm. So with that, I found that in listening to the message, I'm able to have a different kind of conversation with her, because mm-hmm. I can talk about what I'm hearing, what mm-hmm. she's hearing, what she believes, and then we can dive into discussion of simply, what does the Bible say, and how is this in agreement with, or in contrast to, what is in the Bible? And so we've been able to have some really good discussions as a result of that. Mm-hmm. At the same time, I think if you're not guarded, I know if you're not guarded, mm-hmm. the things that you continue to hear
yes.
will start to become
doctrine to you,
or a little less surprising, or a little yes. less antagonistic. It's just, you know, it's a little bit more welcoming the more that you hear it. So mm-hmm. you do have to guard your mind and your heart and be yes. very prayerful. So don't take it lightly mm-hmm. as though, oh, everything will just be fine no matter what. Because you do need God to go with you into mm-hmm. that environment.
Amen.
Right.
And I think we should remember, it's not a situation where we're going to make this habitual. It's right. not like, okay, we're going to be doing this thing every weekend where you come to me on Saturday, I go to you on Sunday. So
right.
like, we're just all weekend long going to
no,
church together.
Right.
No, it's not like that. Okay,
mm-hmm.
I've invited you to church.
Mm-hmm.
You are also a person who is a Christian of a different denomination. And
mm-hmm.
you're like, okay, so
mm-hmm.
I'll come to your church and you come to my church.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is going to be a one-time thing, right? What, and so on and so forth. If
mm-hmm.
you believe that you want to come back to my church again, the doors are always open.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not going to become a regular member at your church. I'm not going to become a regular visitor
mm-hmm.
to your church because I do not believe in what is being said and so on. And if you have that same conviction about my church,
mm-hmm.
by all means, you
yeah.
don't have to come back as well. So
yeah.
I think that's where we always have to, you know, draw the line.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure we know where the clear-cut
mm-hmm.
Line is in all of these situations.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And to expand on that just a little bit, it's we do need a good balance.
Yes.
Right.
I don't think, I'm certain that we shouldn't be so secluded in our own little SDA world
yes.
that we can't even interact appropriately with anyone else because we're just caught off guard that someone believes something that's different from us. We do need to learn how to be able to have conversations with individuals that don't believe exactly what we believe
yes.
and do it in a manner that honors God.
Amen.
We're not here to condemn anyone. We're just here to draw people to Christ and let Him show their heart
mm-hmm.
exactly what is truth, because only He can do that.
Right. Now, if I'd weigh in a bit, I don't think everyone can go.
Also,
sister.
Right? And reason being, if you are not properly grounded, then you could be deceived.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right? So I don't think everyone can go.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That's my first point. Now, the second point is, and I see Dragon is making a similar point there. You invited a person to your church because you want to teach them some truth, or you desire to see them saved.
Yes.
Well, we're not condemning anybody's church here. But if the person wants you to come to theirs just because you invited them to yours,
yeah.
it's kind of contradictory there.
Yeah.
Because they didn't invite you in the first place. But because you invited them, they want to invite you now.
Right.
Right? Now, I've been to other churches, and I remember one Sunday morning I went, and it was different. Alright? It was different. I was invited to come to church with someone. I said, you know what, okay, let me go with them. Alright, no problem, because I did invite them to church one time, and they came. So I went. It was different. Need to say the least, I couldn't participate in everything they were doing. Right? Because it was contrary to what I believed.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It was contrary to our message. Okay? But it's not something that I would promote doing. Right? Now, you may be invited to speak in somebody else's church during their service. And it's an opportunity where you can share your faith, by all means.
Mm-hmm.
All right? But not to be integrated into the service or the congregation and participating
yes.
as if you're part.
That's right.
Right. Okay. Now, we have to be, that. Go back to the first point I made. Not everyone can go, because Some of us attend our church, but we're not sure what we believe.
That's true.
Now you go over there and you get vibes, if I had to put it that way.
Yes, yes.
Right?
Right.
You like how the music sounds.
Yes.
You find it doing more, well, I would use the word antique, so you find it praising God more.
More,
yeah.
Some of the churches
praising God
look like if they're so spiritually there.
So you end up being entertained.
Yeah,
for sure. Yeah.
Right, and then you come back. And then instead of focusing on the word, you kind of look for the same vibes.
Yes.
All right? So not everyone can go. So I wouldn't say straight off, go. No, I don't believe everyone can go.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have Jordel saying, I advise to the young lady that work on Sabbath, she's doing a good deed, which is what we should do as Christians. What she can do is to give the day's pay as an offering.
Oh, that's a good idea.
All right? Yeah. I think I'll have to speak to the producer. We can expound on that a bit more and come back with an episode. So I'll speak to the producer on that.
I think so. It's a serious one.
Right.
Yes.
Right. So back to what we were speaking about. I don't think everyone should go, and I won't promote going.
And just because we hear success stories doesn't necessarily mean that that is the way that it has to be done.
Exactly.
I saw one comment that was saying, and we're happy about this, that a friend invited you to church, then you invited them to church, and that individual ended up becoming SDA, and they happened to pass, but they passed knowing who God was and His truth.
Right.
So in that case, we are absolutely just praising God for that, and that is a wonderful success story, for lack of a better term. But we still, as you said, would need to be cautious and make sure we're being very prayerful about whether or not to go.
There you go. And also, and I know what Kev Dragon said about a diversion. We need to have a spirit of discernment to know when this individual is asking us purely as a diversion and to keep us like lobbying. Okay, I'm not going to come to your church, unless you come to my church, and then that's just a back and forth. That is not going to go anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Versus if the person is genuinely saying, I believe in this teaching, you believe in this teaching, you would like me to come and hear your teachings, I would like you to do me the same courtesy and come and hear mine, and then we can dialogue and so on and figure out what is the truth.
Right.
So if it's that's the situation, sure. But if it's just a diversion, as Kevin is saying, where that person is just trying to stall because they really don't want to come to your church, so they're just stalling, then you just move on. Just let that be that, right?
Right. I saw someone also speaking about the other sheep, right? remember, you're not condemning anyone here.
Of course not.
Right, you're not condemning anyone. Christ's wish, and I'm pretty sure that it's ours as well, is that everyone would be saved. Right, so we're not condemning anyone. And yes, we show ourselves friendly in a lot of different ways. Right, and we wish that everyone would be saved. Somebody was also asking, who is Ellen White? Who was that?
Barbara.
Right. Ellen White is the person that we believe is our last, right? But we had someone answer. Ellen White is a prophetess, right? That's the prophet or prophetess of the last day prophet, right? Of the Seventh Day Adventist Church, some call it. Now in Revelation, we learn that the God's remnant church would keep the commandments of God and have what?
The testimony of Jesus Christ.
And the testimony, of Jesus Christ is described as the spirit of prophecy. Okay? I hope I answered your question. We could expound on that some more. If you like some more information, you can always send us a message on the page.
And we can
enlighten you some more. Okay? Right.
Rhonda's letting us know also the comment prior, she was saying that she actually taught Sunday school for an entire year, but she used the Sabbath school study for the children.
Yes.
So we can see that God definitely can use us in various different ways.
Yes.
So praise God for that witness.
All right, nice. Now, we're going to go to our final scenario, but before we do that, we need to take a little break, all right, so then we can come back to that. Because I think some of our Cassie has a lot to share. Right? So before we go on to that, we'll take an item of special music. Alright, and then we'll come back to our final scenario. Okay?
Yeah, a lot of music tonight.
Right. And stay tuned in, invite your friends, and keep liking, keep sharing the page as we go along.
I wrote this song. It's called Lord, Take It All. No matter what we face, we serve a God who is more than able to deliver us and to set us free. All we need to do is to give Him our worries. God is great and He's mighty. There's nothing He cannot do. Hallelujah. Song goes like this. Sometimes I'm discouraged. Sometimes I am weary, oh Lord. Sometimes I am not myself. Sometimes I am down. But I know my Jesus, He is looking out for me. Yes, Lord, I'm gonna give You all my pain. I'm gonna cast it on Him. So, Lord, take it all. Take all of my pain. I surrender all. I surrender all of my shame. God, You are good. Lord, You are God. God, You are good. Lord, You are God. So I surrender all. Satan is a liar. He's the great deceiver. He is coming after you. So let me tell you what to do. Surrender to Jesus. Call upon His mighty name. He will save you. There's nothing He can do. So, Lord, take it all. Take it all. Take all of my pain. I surrender all. I surrender all of my shame. God, You are good. Lord, You are God. God, You are good. Lord, You are God. So I surrender all. Jesus is coming soon. The trumpets will sound. People, be ready to be in that city. No more pain, no more sorrow. A brighter tomorrow. I can't wait to get there. To be with my Father. So, Lord, take it all. Take it all. Take all of my pain. I surrender all, I surrender all of my shame. God, You are good. Lord, You are God. God, You are good. Lord, You are God. So I surrender all. So, Lord, take it all. Take it all. Take all of my pain. I surrender all. I surrender all of my shame. God, You are good. Lord, You are God. God, You are good. Lord, You are God. So I surrender all. God, You are good. Lord, you are God. God, you are good. Lord, you are God. So I surrender all. God, you are good. Lord, you are God. God, you are good. Lord, you are God. So I surrender all.
Welcome back, and I'm sure you enjoyed that special music from Kellon George. Okay, Kellon, that was a good song. Yep. Right. So we are on our final scenario, and I hope you will invite your friends to join. Now listen to this. It's a bit different from the other three that we did. Now you are unmarried, right? And you have not seen your fiancé for the past 12 months. So you're engaged to be married. You're unmarried now. You haven't seen your fiancé for the past 12 months because you were studying. So you all are in different parts. How far away you are? One is in the
Australia.
US?
Australia.
Australia?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So arrangements were made for them to stay with a friend during a visit. So they came to visit you and you made arrangements to stay with a friend. Right? Now, unfortunately, the friend had an emergency and did not leave the keys. So the friend had to run out and the friend didn't leave the keys. So they are here now and they are at your apartment. Your apartment is a studio apartment.
Hmm.
Right? A studio apartment. You are basically utilize all the space. You pull along your couch, stretch it out, your couch becomes the bed. Alright? So you don't have no extra place to sleep. Okay? Now, it's late. Now, previously, you were sexually active with your fiancé.
Yeah.
But you all determined to make a change.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Amen for that?
Yeah.
Right? You all decided to make a change. But now, you are in a compromising position.
I'm always in one.
Right. So, it's late. The friend went out. Didn't leave the keys for the apartment.
Mm-hmm.
And your fiancé is with you in your studio apartment. Now, the only place to sleep is the couch. What do you do?
Somebody take the floor.
What do you do?
I'm kidding. Go ahead, keep it.
Okay, I'm just putting this out there. I am not sexually active, okay? I'm just putting that out there. Never have been.
Congratulations.
Yeah, congratulations. Thank you. Yeah, right. Staging it all over the internet. Good job. Here we go. I mean, y'all had to sleep in the same bed. I mean, come on. There's no way around it. Unless, you know, one man stand up and one man sleep down. I mean, unless you're planning on asking the Lord for a manger at this moment. I mean, y'all had to sleep in the same bed, so. Try to keep, you know, make a pillow barrier between y'all.
I love the spice that you add to these things. This is great. So, if you were previously sexually active and it is your goal to remain that way, which I suppose it's been easy long distance,
yes,
it's not possible. But now you haven't seen each other for a long time, which means you miss each other even more.
Tension.
You have not been able to hold so much as hold a hand or anything like this. Let's be real. God made our bodies in a particular manner. And most of us, our bodies are functioning the way that it's supposed to. And so when sparks fly and tingly feelings and all kind of things like that, we have to be temptation. We have to be realistic with ourselves. You put a pillow between you and your fiancé who you haven't seen, who you love, who you're about to marry and have sex anyway, and see how long the pillow's going to stay between the two of you guys. Let's be honest with her, and I appreciate your honesty with that. So, the best way to not yield to temptation is to avoid it all together. Don't put yourself in a situation where you know you're going to be struggling.
This so reminds me of last week when we tackled this something very similar to this, when we did the whole program on sex, and it's basically you are putting yourself in the way of temptation. That is it. That is the weakness right there, because you guys have fallen for the weakness for the weaknesses before, mm-hmm. because you were sexually active before, mm-hmm. and now, this is prime situation to fall back into that situation. You just opened the door for the weakness to just right. take over. I believe it may be the hardest thing to do, because especially if you're the guy, you don't want your fiance, you the protective one, to be, you know, you don't know where she's going to stay for the night, you don't mm-hmm. want to leave her alone, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. So, of course, you're going to stay with me, but now, what does that mean?
Right.
What does that mean, you're staying with me? There is one bed.
Mm-hmm.
Even if I say I'm going to sleep on the floor, you sleep on the bed, you're still in the same room.
I'm going to stay
out. You're still in the same room.
Yeah, remember, it's a studio apartment.
Exactly. So, like, floor and bed, like, it's, mm. listen, you need to, I don't know how you're going to do it, it's going to be hard, but you have to figure out a way to get her out of the apartment, because I'm not saying that.
Ouch.
I'm not saying that you may not have the restraint, mm-hmm. you may not have the willpower. I am not saying that you have not reached to a point where God really has transformed you, that you guys can spend the whole night together in that apartment and nothing happens if you have, praise the Lord. But if you haven't, you have to figure out some way, no matter how late it is, if you really, really want to avoid falling back into that weakness, to get her out of the apartment. Or you have to get out of the apartment, or somebody has to go. But we can't stay there together for that night. It just can't happen.
Desiree? Okay, listen, Desiree. Honestly, the pillow barrier won't work. I'm just putting it out there again. But you should have self-control. You should have self-control. No, really. I mean,
listen to me. It is a hot day. Extremely,
okay,
extremely hot day.
Mm-hmm.
You are walking down the street and
mm-hmm.
you come upon a stand where little kids are selling ice popsicles,
mm-hmm.
the juice popsicle things. However, you know you have a weakness for sweet things, and you said, okay, I'm not having sweet things again. I'm not doing it. I'm stopping. You are walking toward the stand, the chair with the nice, pretty juice popsicles, and it is hot. Hot, sweat dripping down your brow. That juice popsicle will make you feel better instantly.
Okay, question. We still talking about the popsicle?
I'm talking
like
about the fact that you're getting close to the falling for a weakness, because you don't want to have the sweet things, but you're so hot,
mm-hmm.
and the popsicle is right there in front of you. It's so easy just to touch it, and you saying have self control when that heat is on you, bro. Like, self control kind of goes out the window. Like,
we have to make sure we never overestimate
yourself.
Your self-control, exactly.
Don't overestimate, because the flesh is truly and genuinely
weak.
The strength that we have comes from Christ,
amen.
Which He gives through the Spirit. And
amen.
If we are not walking in the Spirit, we are not accessing said strength.
There you go.
Therefore, we are automatically weak. I don't care how much intentions were pure in the beginning. Don't even put yourself in that situation.
And then we start to rationalize, well, I can't put her out because what kind of man would I be to put my girlfriend, my fiance out in the street at night? We're going to get married anyway.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've stayed so good for so long. We've restrained for 12 months. The Lord is going to understand.
Right. You know,
rationalize, and then all of a sudden...
Mm-hmm.
Right. We have some comments coming in
mm-hmm.
online.
Mm-hmm.
Rhonda says, get them a hotel room.
Yes.
The problem here is that this is late, right? So it's a tough one, right? But then she came back and said, get them a hotel room. Now, John Max is saying, James on it, blessed is the man that endured temptation, for when he's tried, he shall receive the crumb of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love Him.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Ketisha is giving some advice. She says, leave the apartment to your fiance.
Yes.
There you go.
And see if you can stay at another friend or family member's
exactly.
house.
Exactly.
So
there you go.
If you're that gentleman that doesn't want to leave your fiance,
you leave.
You get out.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
Here's
so,
the bathroom. Here's the key. I'll see you in the morning.
Do like Joseph and flee.
No, listen.
Wait, hold on. Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
But are you telling me that it's so hard not to? I mean, okay. In all local terms, you sample it already. So, you know,
right.
Relax yourself.
So listen to this. While it's true that there's no temptation that God has not provided a way of escape for us,
mm-hmm.
however, you don't go into the temptation and then ask God to provide a way out. Alright? You don't go into it. So, you're an alcoholic, or you was an alcoholic, sorry.
Mm-hmm.
You don't go into back into that environment. Right? You don't go back into that environment to see how strong you are. Alright? Instead, you call persons out of it. Okay? So, you all were previously sexually active.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Well, the scenario doesn't say this, but probably the reason why you were not sexually active because of distance.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, she was away?
Mm-hmm.
And then you all decided over that time, well, let's remain pure.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Until we get married. Now, obviously, if you end up in a tight spot, right, the flesh is weak.
Mm-hmm.
Paul said the things that he wants to do, what happened?
He's not doing it.
And then the things that he doesn't want to do, he finds himself doing it.
Alright?
So the flesh is weak. So then, and I said the flesh is weak, and I'm thinking, you're going to put flesh together again. Alright? The flesh is weak. You don't put yourself back into that situation. Alright? Now, unfortunately, your fiancé didn't get the apartment that they had to stay in.
Mm-hmm.
So you're at your apartment.
Right?
And it's lit. You might be looking at it as a test from God. No, it's probably the devil trying to set you up.
Uh-huh.
Okay? We have to be smart. We have to be wise.
There you go.
Okay?
The devil just wants a little in.
Exactly. Right? So we have, and the advice coming in online are good. You have to leave the apartment. I'm not saying put her out. But no, you know, we just speak of that as the apartment is the guy's.
Yeah.
We didn't even say if it was the other way around.
Yeah.
But let's say you're the guy, then no, you have to. You can't expect to stay there all night and then say God will, you know, take control. Alright?
And just to promote your point,
mm-hmm.
the Bible says in Matthew 5:29-30,
mm-hmm.
and if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out,
yes.
cast it from thee, for it's
mm-hmm.
profitable that one member of the should perish and not the whole body.
Yes.
So
that's a very good point.
Right. The text
mm-hmm.
speaks to how drastic the action should be,
mm-hmm.
just so that you wouldn't fall back in that sin.
Mm-hmm.
Even if
mm-hmm.
it requires you, like, paying someone just to stay by them,
mm-hmm.
do it.
Mm-hmm.
No matter, you know. God says, take the drastic measure. Don't fall back into that sin that offends you.
Yes.
Resist
yes.
the very appearance.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Very good point. Very good point. As Pastor Hiller would say, poor point. Right? Poor point.
Okay. I can only speak from a personal point of view. I can get general, but honestly, right about now, I'm going personal with this. I have had opportunities to, you know,
okay.
pretty much, and I have said no.
And that's very good.
And
it's wonderful for you.
Yes.
Basically, again, I wouldn't go putting her out of the apartment. Y'all could sleep on the same bed, but you know, if you get to the certain level of self-control and again respect, because if she personally, okay, if we were sexually active before, fine. If she said that she wants to stay pure and we agree to stay pure, I am respecting her wishes because there is this feeling you get in the morning. You know you shouldn't have done it, but you did it, and it's like, it's not a good feeling. But to wake up in the morning saying, yes, we survived this temptation, it makes you better for it.
No, I like your spirit. I like your spirit. And I like... Yes, but I like the way he's speaking too, because you see, there's a difference here. Now, remember, they were sexually active before.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you speaking on the basis of being chaste,
mm-hmm.
right? So then there's a difference here. If you never tasted alcohol,
mm-hmm.
you have no desire for it because you don't know what it tastes like.
I mean, both of us mean sexually active.
Right?
I'm speaking
because you said
yeah.
you put a disclaimer on already.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
that's very good. So because you never had sex before,
mm-hmm.
you don't feel the desire for it like how they would feel.
Oh no, I feel the desire.
No, understand what I'm saying. Understand what I'm saying here.
I understand.
They would have memories of it.
Yes, yes. The whole thing.
They would have memories of it, right? While you may imagine what it is. Right? No, but that's good.
Yeah.
That's good. That's good. So, if you have memories of a thing, the devil would keep playing it back, right? And then you keep pondering because he would give you certain suggestions. He can't read your thoughts, but he would pass things by you to see, right? To see what vibe he picks up from you, all right? Now, and the same example as alcohol, you never tasted it. You can't be tempted that way. In their situation, they were sexually active, right? They decided to remain chaste. And here, they're being put into a trap, if I would call it.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Very nice trap, though.
Right. Best thing to do, get out of the trap.
Get out of the trap. Don't even try to say, okay, I can get out of the trap while I'm in it, or whatever it is. No, just avoid the trap. Run from the trap.
It seems to be, based on our discussion and differences of how we would approach it, is do you see it as a trap?
Mm-hmm.
Is it even a trap to you? Or is this just another scenario and we're just going to hang out and whatever happens, happens? I'm pretty sure we'll be fine, but eh. Or do you see it as, no, my right hand is offending me.
Yeah.
It's gone.
There we go.
So you got to do a little heart check for this situation and make sure that you're being guided by the right motivations.
And coming back, sorry, go ahead.
I think in that same situation, they did see it as a trap. That's why they made provisions to stay at the
front. Right.
Exactly.
So I think they were really trying not to fall back in that trap.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it just happened that the provisions made just
didn't
fall through.
Right. And this is a typical example of not waiting to get to the bridge to cross.
Because
if you wait to get to the bridge, you may not.
You may not make it.
You have to make up your mind. Daniel purpose in his heart
long before.
Right? So you have to make up your mind long before. Right? So when you see the trap is being set, you walk away from that trap.
One pastor I remember saying along the same context.
Those online, you can start sending your prayer requests because we are about to wrap up. So start sending your prayer requests. Go ahead.
Just a quick comment. I do remember a comment that stayed with me, which is there are some decisions that if not made ahead of time will not be made.
Exactly.
So you've got to have it already decided prior to, or else that good decision will not be made.
Mm-hmm.
So just to take a look at what Rajal is saying, he says, but we are tested and tried all the time.
Amen.
We must know that we are strong in the Lord. In the Lord, yes. I agree with the brother, self-control must be exercised. We cannot, as Christians, keep falling prey to sin. God is coming for a prepared people. We are wavering in our relationship with the Lord. We are like the waves of the ocean. We need to armor ourselves with the Holy Spirit because we are on a real battlefield.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for that comment.
Just point. As you said, to avoid temptation. Now, if that was the case, we would never understand or be ever tempted because we'd be forever avoiding it. No one would go through temptation.
No,
so
avoid yielding to
temptation. No, what you say, but I'm thinking about her, what she said in the context is that you're avoiding the temptation entirely.
Mm-hmm.
Again.
You're avoiding the
creating it yourself.
Yes. Avoiding creating yourself and avoiding the whole, we're just feeling it right now. Avoiding you falling to it, or
right,
avoiding
so
creating a trap for you to
right.
fall to the temptation,
mm-hmm.
right? That's kind of what it is. So you know that this is a weakness that you have. Then just avoid any situation that's going to lead you into falling into that temptation.
But then what happens if the temptation was not caused by you? What happens if it was caused by somebody else and you have no way out of it? What happened then?
Let me address this.
Okay.
The strength that you're exercising is in the beginning.
Right.
You don't decide to exercise the strength after you're already feeling the weakness. You exercise it from the beginning. So it's not that avoiding it makes you not capable of handling should a situation arise. No, you already experienced and practiced that before it gets bad. I am already making up my mind. This is not going to take place.
Right. Exactly. And same thing Nova is saying.
All right.
Yes. There we go.
Let me share this thoughts with you. God has made provisions for us in every aspect of our lives. And in fact, in 1 Corinthians 10, 13, it says, "There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. Furthermore, he promises us that he will never leave us nor forsake us. We therefore have to take hope in every situation that may assail us. God is there. His words are there to provide guidance to us so that we are not led astray." Let us continue searching the scriptures. I think that's what we have to do.
Yeah.
We search for principles and guidelines and how our behavior and motive should be in every situation. Okay? So as I said, we have to make up our minds long before.
Mm-hmm.
Not wait until we get to the point and then decide what to do. Right? Once we follow God's bidding, whenever we are faced with a tough life decision or temptation, God has already provided the answer for us. Okay? Right. And I think this brings us to a wrap for tonight. Right? Remember to send in your prayer requests as we're about to close up. But I think in the meantime, we can probably start the prayers and pray that God would guide us into our decision making and help us not to yield to any weak areas, any temptations that we may have. Okay? Right. We'll ask Travis. You can do that prayer for us.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, we're praying for
God to continue to lead us and guide us so that we may not fall prey to temptation.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So let's all pray, and y'all could keep sending your prayer requests. God will see it and answer it. Okay. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before your presence thanking you for everything that you have done for each and every one of us. You have made each and every one of our bodies, you know, our minds, our hearts, our desires. And you know, Father, what we fall prey to. You know our weaknesses as well. Lord, we pray that you continue to be with each and every one of us as we strive to be more like you. Continue to fill us with your Holy Spirit so that we can be guided. And Lord, help us to stay strong in your word, Father. Help us to read, understand, and follow it, Father. But help us to rely on you. Lord, we know, Father, we cannot do anything in our own strength, Father, because the flesh is weak, but we know that the Spirit is willing. Continue to be with us, O Father, Lord, in our Christian walk. The prayer requests that are coming in, Father, Lord, you know each and every one of them. Continue to be with the people who are sending them in. Lord, watch them, Father, Lord. Answer their prayers, Father, Lord. You know, Father, that we want to be more like you. Continue to be with us, O Father, and help us. Forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This is our prayer through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. We have Sylvia Lally asking for prayers for all her siblings and their children to come back to the fold of God before it's too late. Alright, you want to do that prayer for us?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for prayer. We thank you for family. We thank you for the relationships that you bless us with. We know that you are a God of relationship, and the individuals that we come in contact with, that we're able to enjoy fellowship with, we thank you. And so it is particularly distressing and painful when we see these individuals that we love outside of your ark of safety, outside of your will, and perhaps even unknowingly just harming themselves as they live lives that are not in line with what you would have. But Lord, we know that we can never go so far that you stop loving us, that we can never be in such a situation that coming back to you is no longer an option, Father. So we pray that for Sylvia's family in particular, those individuals that are heavy on her heart, that you would just intervene in their life in such a way that they would see you, who you truly are. They would see your love, that they would see even your law and the beauty of it, that they would see how you only desire to help us to grow closer to you, which would bring us joy and peace, and all of the yearnings that we seek in the world will never be found there, at least not in the depth that you would provide those yearnings and fill us, God, in the way that the world never could. So I pray that you would open their eyes to that reality, that you are light, that you are love, that you are everything that they could ever want and more. I pray, Lord, that they would accept you as their Savior, and that they would spread the gospel to those in their immediate circle. And I also pray for anyone else watching and all the families represented, the same prayer, Lord, that you would make yourself known in their life, that they would come and see you for who you are and turn to you and never turn back away from you, Father. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right. So as we wrap up tonight, we just want to thank all those who tuned in. All right. We want you to tune in next Friday. We'll be back, please God, once God gives us life and health. Okay? Thank you. Thank everyone. And good night. Pleasant Sabbath.
Good night.
Bye.
Share your love and grace in all I do. Lord, I come before you with contrite heart.
Please draw me close to you.
Humbly I surrender as I am. I want to love from you.
Please draw me close to you.
Let me share your love and grace in all I do. Trust and love you.